Giant cell arteritis is an autoimmune disease of the large and medium-sized arteries. As most autoimmune disorders, giant cell arteritis affects mostly women. The most common targets of giant cell arteritis are carotid arteries and especially temporal arteries. Because of this, the second name of this disorder is temporal arteritis. The signature feature of giant cell arteritis is the presence of giant cells and overgrowth of the intima. And the signature symptoms are vision loss that can cause even blindness and jaw claudication. Also, we have to know that giant cell arteritis is often associated with polymyalgia rheumatica that manifests with muscle pain and joint pain. So first of all, we have to know the pathogenesis of this vasculitis. In blood vessel wall, we have a lining of endothelial cells. Under the endothelium, located subendothelial extracellular matrix, which is composed mostly of collagen. Large arteries also have vasovasorum that provide nutrients delivery to the blood vessel wall. Also, arteries have smooth muscle cells that provide contractility. And the production of collagen is provided by the specific cells called fibroblasts. Sometimes some viral agents as mycoplasma pneumonia or parvovirus can cause infection. And during infection, when our immune system begins to fight viruses, the degradation of viral particles causes formation of a byproducts as glycoproteins. And such byproducts we call PAMP, which stands for pathogen-associated molecular patterns, and DAMP, which stands for damage-associated molecular pattern. When these small particles appear in some tissue, macrophages consume these particles and then present some parts of these particles on MHC2 receptor to T helpers. The logic is that antigen-presenting cell want to know, is this particle normal material or it's something pathogenic? T helpers scan particle and in normal condition, T helper recognize such particle as a normal substance, and thereby they do not trigger inflammation. But some people have MHC2 receptors that are produced based on HLA-DRB1 alleles. And in this case, most probably, inflammation will develop. And to understand why, we have to know how antigen presentation occurs. In normal condition, when PAMP are produced, macrophages intake particles in order to present these particles to T helpers. And antigen presentation occurs by MHC2 receptor. What we have to know about MHC2 receptor is that it's a protein. And the genetic information that tells us how to make MHC2 receptor is contained in the gene that is located on chromosome 6. We call this gene HLA-DRB gene. But we have different variations of HLA-DRB genes, and such variations we call alleles. The simplest analogy is the eye color. You see, we all have genes that encode the color of our eyes. But some of us have blue eyes and some of us have black eyes. And in this case, genes that encode blue eyes we call blue allele, and genes that encode black eyes, black allele. So, we all have genes that encode eye color, but this gene can be different. And different variations, which are blue and black colors, of the same gene that in this case encodes eyes, we call alleles. So, in case of giant cell arteritis, we all have genes that encode MHC2 receptor. We call this gene HLA-DRB gene. But this gene can be different, and different variations of HLA-DRB gene we call HLA-DRB alleles. For example, if person has HLA-DRB3 allele, this person will have MHC2 receptor that was made based on genetic information in HLA-DRB3 allele. And such MHC2 receptor presents particles in a perfectly normal way. And when T helpers come to this receptor, they recognize this particle as a normal substance, and because of this, they do not see any danger. If person has HLA-DRB4 allele, this person will have MHC2 receptor that was made based on genetic information in HLA-DRB4 allele. and such MHC II receptor presents particle also in a perfectly normal way. Thereby, there will be no inflammatory response. If person has HLA-DLB7 allele, this person will have MHC II receptor that was made based on genetic information in HLA-DLB7 allele, and such MHC II receptor also presents particle in a perfectly normal way, so there will be no inflammatory response. But some individuals have HLA-DLB1 allele. Thereby, in this case, person will have MHC II receptor that was made based on genetic information in HLA-DLB1 allele. The problem is that this particular MHC II receptor do not know how to present particles to T helpers. When T helpers income to MHC II receptor, in this case, because this particle is presented in abnormal way, they cannot recognize particle, and thereby they think that it's antigen. In response to any antigen, T helpers immediately becomes activated, and subsequently they activate B lymphocytes that begin to produce interleukin-6, and also they activate macrophages. So in individuals that have HLA-DLB1 allele, MHC II receptor presents particles in abnormal way, and because of this, T helpers recognize pump or dump as antigens, and in response to antigen, T helpers becomes activated. Once T helper becomes activated, T helper, by production of interleukin-6, activate B lymphocytes. If B lymphocytes becomes activated, first of all, by production of interleukin-6, they stimulate fibroblast. Also, in activated state, B lymphocytes excessively proliferate, and potentially this can cause formation of ectopic lymphoid structures. And other cells that T helpers stimulate are macrophages. T helpers produce interleukin-6 and TNF that activate macrophages. Massive activation of macrophages results in their proliferation and fusion, with formation of giant cells. Giant cells begin to produce TGF-beta and platelet-driven growth factor. Both these molecules provide strong stimulation of fibroblasts. In response to these two stimuli, fibroblast becomes activated. In activated state, fibroblast becomes myofibroblast, and the specific feature of myofibroblast is abnormally massive production of collagen. So the amount of collagen in extracellular matrix begin to increase. And because collagen is a major component of extracellular matrix, with increasing amount of collagen molecules, the size of extracellular matrix increase. So the thickness of intima increase, and thereby the radius of the vessels decrease. Also, giant cells begin to produce vascular endothelial growth factor, which provides increasing amount of vasovasorum and smooth muscle cells in the blood vessel wall. So as a result, intima becomes very thick, and now we call it neointima. And the thicker becomes intima, the smaller becomes the radius of the blood vessel. And the more narrow is the blood vessel, the lower is the blood flow through the vessel, and thereby the lower will be the nutrients delivery to the tissues. And it's a major problem in giant cell arteritis. So how blood supply works? Heart pushes blood into the aorta, from aorta blood moves into the common carotid artery, and from common carotid artery blood moves into the external carotid artery. External carotid artery has a few branches. It's maxillary artery that supply blood to masseter muscle, it's temporal artery that supply blood to scalp, especially to the temporal region of the scalp, and lingual artery that supply blood to tongue. Also, from common carotid artery, blood is moving into internal carotid artery. And internal carotid artery has a few branches. It's ophthalmic artery that delivers blood to eyes. It's inferolateral trunk that supply blood to cranial nerves. And it's cerebral arteries that supply blood to brain tissue. From physics, we know that blood flow, for example, from left ventricle to common carotid artery, is directly proportional to the pressure difference between left ventricle and common carotid artery, divided on resistance between them. and the resistance is inversely proportional to the force power of radius. But if giant cell arteritis develops, and one of the major targets of this vasculitis is common carotid artery, now vasculitis induces severe inflammation and fibrosis of the common carotid artery. With fibrosis, neointima develops, and formation of neointima significantly decreases the lumen of the artery. So, if fibrosis develops, the radius of the artery decreases. With decrease in radius, resistance increases. With increase in resistance, blood flow decreases. With decrease in blood flow through the common carotid artery, the delivery of blood to internal carotid artery and its branches decrease. With decrease in blood delivery to ophthalmic artery, ischemia of eyes develops, and this can end up even in complete blindness. With decrease in blood delivery to inferolateral trunk, ischemia of cranial nerves develops, and this can cause cranial neuropathy. With decrease in blood delivery to cerebral arteries, brain ischemia develops, and brain ischemia can manifest with ischemic stroke or tear-like symptoms. Also, with decrease in blood flow through the common carotid artery, the delivery of blood to external carotid artery and its branches decrease. With decrease in blood delivery to maxillary artery, ischemia of masseter muscle develops, and this can cause jaw claudication. With decrease in blood delivery to temporal artery, ischemia of scalp develops, and this can cause temporal headache and scalp tenderness. With decrease in blood delivery to lingual artery, ischemia of tongue develops, and this can cause tongue claudication. So basically, it's the pathogenesis of the major clinical symptoms. But in clinical medicine, to make a diagnosis, we use a diagnostic criteria. The first criteria is age older than 50, because this disorder usually develops in old age. The second criteria is morning stiffness in shoulders and neck, because very often giant cell arteritis is associated with polymyalgia rheumatica, and it's the signature features of polymyalgia. The third criteria is sudden visual loss. And as we know, vision loss develops due to the decrease in blood delivery through the ophthalmic artery to the eyes. The fourth criteria is jaw tongue claudication. Jaw claudication develops due to the ischemia of masseter muscle, and tongue claudication develops due to the decrease in blood delivery through the lingual artery to the tongue. The fifth and sixth criteria are new temporal headache and scalp tenderness. The reason why temporal headache and scalp tenderness develops is decrease in blood delivery through the temporal artery to the scalp. The seventh criteria is abnormal examination of the temporal artery, because carotid arteries and their branches are the common targets, but most frequently this vasculitis affects exactly temporal artery. The first laboratory criteria are the markers of severe inflammation. It's erythrocyte sedimentation rate and C-reactive protein. Increase in ESR more than 50 and CRP more than 10 are the markers of severe inflammation. The second laboratory criteria is positive temporal artery biopsy and halo sign on ultrasound. First of all, about biopsy. On biopsy, we can determine overgrowth of intima. On this picture, it's called internal elastic lamina. And formation of neointima causes decrease in radius of the blood vessel. Also, we see giant cells, which is a fusion of macrophages, and it's a signature feature of vasculitis. And also, we see a lot of B lymphocytes. So, on this picture, it's giant cells, and also we see a lot of lymphocytes that can even form ectopic lymphoid structures. And also, we see huge neointima. And such huge neointima cause a significant decrease in lumen of the blood vessel. Here we practically do not see lumen at all. On ultrasound, we have a specific criteria called halo sign. So here we see lumen of the blood vessel, and around we can see extremely thick blood vessel wall that creates this high density around the lumen of the blood vessel. And high density gives this dark color. If we compare this image to normal image below, we see that in normal condition, we practically do not see blood vessel wall. So extremely thick blood vessel wall forms so-called Hello sign, which is a signature feature of giant cell arteritis. On this image, we again see a narrow lumen and very thick blood vessel wall. And on the image below, we see a normal picture, where we have huge lumen and thin blood vessel wall. On this image, we again see lumen of the blood vessel, and around lumen, we see dark area, which is in fact extremely thick blood vessel wall. And exactly this thick dark area around the lumen we call Hello sign. And the last criteria is positive PET CT throughout the aorta. It's the most modern method of diagnosis. To explain this, we have to know that area that have the highest brightness or areas that have the darkest color are the most metabolically active. And one of the reasons why tissue can become more metabolically active is inflammation. So on first image, we can see areas of high intensity across the aorta, subclavian and axillary arteries. And in color, we can see areas of high intensity throughout the thoracic aorta and in axillary arteries. As we see, these areas have high brightness, thereby they have high metabolic activity, which in this case caused by very severe inflammation. On the second image, we can see high intensity in subclavian arteries, and in this case, such intensity is caused by severe inflammation of the arteries. And overall, to make a diagnosis, we need more than 6 points. For treatment, we use two major medications. First of all, it's glucocorticosteroids, because they induce apoptosis of lymphocytes. So with intake of glucocorticosteroids, the amount of lymphocytes begin to decrease. And because lymphocytes are the key players in pathogenesis, this causes decreasing stimulation of fibroblasts, and thereby this causes decreasing collagen production. As a result, the thickness of neointima begin to decrease. The next major drug is methotrexate. The alternative for methotrexate is azathioprine. These two drugs are non-selective, so they have a lot of side effects, but they are extremely potent. The new selective drug is tocilizumab, its interleukin-6 inhibitor. Basically, tocilizumab blocks interleukin-6. And because interleukin-6 is a major cytokine in pathogenesis, this can markedly decrease inflammation, and as a result, it can significantly decrease the growth of neointima. Abatacept is co-stimulation inhibitor. Abatacept blocks activation of T helpers. If T helpers remain inactivated, they cannot stimulate B lymphocytes or macrophages. As a result, stimulation of fibroblasts decrease and neointima decrease.